And then our current primary resource that is not meeting the science of reading, is that the FNP? Okay, and then this is just like kind of like a history of the science of reading question. Not sure if you know, but did that used to be the norm in teaching, was the science of reading, and then it switched over to the three cueing?
The balanced literacy approach.
So it's really just been kind of a pendulum. So it's really just a history of, I could give you a history of reading.
Yeah.
And it would take me maybe an hour.
Yeah, that's okay.
It has gone through that cycle,
yeah,
where it has been a phonics-based approach. It did swing to a more of a whole word approach. Then it went to a balanced reading approach, which is really kind of what FNP is. It does incorporate some phonics. It's not explicit. It's not systematic. It does kind of have that balanced approach, but it does embed the three cueing.
Mm-hmm.
It does not have the systematic and the explicit. So it's more of, it's really considered a balanced literacy versus mm-hmm. the structured literacy, which is what science of reading is geared toward.
Okay.
And so because of that, it just does not meet the requirements of
sure.
the bill. And really, that curriculum is probably one of the most popular curriculums across the United States.
Mm-hmm.
And so when it was chosen most likely because it was one of the most popular and
sure.
well-liked curriculums in the United States.
And so, but this law is just applies to Wisconsin, so other places maybe still use it. I'm like, that's unfortunate for them if everybody can't use it anymore, right?
It does, so. Right.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. What are the consequences if this is not passed by 27-28 school year? We don't hit those benchmarks.
So we have to, whether or not we would adopt a new primary resource, we have to change our instructional practices. So that would mean that we would have to start piecemealing. So we would need to start adapting. We do need to adopt a new explicit phonics program. So we would need to piecemeal that, and we would need to adopt that no matter what. So if we would keep Fontes and Pinnell as our primary resource, we would have to adopt just a phonics piece. And that would be, that would be per building. So we could have each building choose whatever phonics piece. Like some buildings are using a UFLY and some are using foundations, and we could continue to do that, and each building would be doing something different. Or we could do it uniformly. But then we would have to, each and all of the teachers are going to have to go through a training for science of reading. But then that would mean that we would have to teach them how not to use the three cueing system with a curriculum that they're already using that embeds it. So then we would have to reteach and retrain how to use a curriculum that is not structured that way, and how to use it in a different way with materials that it's not designed to be used that way. So we would really be piecemealing and bringing in different pieces and bringing in decodable readers that we don't have to use with a curriculum that is different. So it would be in my what I have been learning since I've been here, kind of back to a system where we were piecemealing and bringing in different pieces where it wasn't uniform. And my fear would be that we wouldn't have uniformity across the district, and that we wouldn't know what was happening in one building versus another building versus another building, and that would be difficult, especially building those personal learning plans for each one of the students, because you would have something going on differently in one building versus another building. Even though our training would be similar, I think that would be difficult. So we would make sure that we would have all of the training in place by 27-28. So we would hit those marks for sure. That would be my answer to that.
Could I just add to make a point that it is very clear that there's going to be high precision no matter what we do, but to have very challenging barriers such as curriculum that may not be aligned would be the work of our teachers and the work of our whole teams. And I do believe, and barring the factors that we really can consider, such as there is a budgeting factor, you know, there is a sequence of timelines that we have to move teachers through high fidelity instruction training. Having a misaligned curriculum is not the end of everything, but it actually is another precise step that we have to take, which leaves a lot of risk on the table. So I just want to put that out there. That doesn't mean we preclude it whatsoever, but everybody needs to understand, if you were going on a NASA mission, you wouldn't plan it that way, because you do want to land somewhere and you do want to discover amazing things. But if we didn't have those things, we would still try to land, but it would just be very hard. So that would be just my analogy for what Heather and the team is talking about. Thank you, Heather.
I just wanted to say that I appreciate everyone pivoting, because this law has come down. So it sounds like you're putting some training that you might have done on the back burner to make accommodations to do this training. So I appreciate that. And then you said it was the bottom 20% of students. So we're looking at a number in the thousands, like in over 1,000 students would be impacted by this act, essentially, because we have over 5,000 students in the district. So if you're saying that
June?
For the K-3 students.
So Heather, Tina's right here, so she's a good resource. Tina, do you have that information? She does have that macro data.
I do have some numbers. So if we pretended that that law was in place right now, when we did our STAR screening in fall, we had anywhere from 20 to 28% of our kids between grades K and 3 that their test score put them under the 25th percentile. So in one grade level, that might mean 75 kids. In another grade level, based off their enrollment, that might mean 60 kids. So we're hoping that some of the things we're putting in place this year will change those numbers once we start testing again next year. And then by the time the bill is done in the 27-28 school year, that number of students that would require that reading plan would continue to shrink and shrink and shrink, because what we're doing universally and via our interventions are effective. So we're living in a what if right now, but if it was this year, it was anywhere from 20 to 28% of our kids.
I also have to say this again, because this is really targeted for K through 3, but it is in the district's best interest, as you have seen, with having a plan that begins in a parallel process for 6-12, because we have to move students through. And so the program evaluation will be very instrumental this year as we conclude it, we conduct it and conclude it, and map out concurrently what is happening under this law, because we have to be ready for the students who are going to be moving from third grade on. So I think that's a significant lift for the district. I think it will be very challenging. There is no law to compel us to do that in any way, but I do think that that is something that you might hear about, to say this is actually very difficult to move the 6-12 in a similar way for them to be ready. So we are thinking about that very concretely, if you will, to say what can we do to get ready in the next 4 years.
All right, thank you so much.
All right, then we'll move on to our next agenda item. I believe Quinn's going to introduce that.
Yeah, so thank you, Heather. Our next presentation for the committee here really is a focus on the district's math plan, equally as important, just not covered under the law. But this plan is actually driven by something that's very powerful, because we do want to ensure that all students have the math skills that are necessary for them to be college and career ready. We have Kelly Downs and Kurt Marquardt, and they will be presenting the district's math plan.
So Curtis and I have been charged with taking a look particularly at 6 through 12, because that's where our data shows us we really need a lot of help. elementary, they've got their hands full, so that's a little bit lighter. So we've dug in deep a little bit more at Silverbrook, Badger, and the high school. And we started with what our mission is. And our mission is to ensure that all, and notice it's capitalized and underlined, that all students have the math skills necessary for college and career readiness. And when we think about what that means as a senior, I get to make choices. I have an education to choose whatever I want, that I'm not limited because in second grade I didn't do well in math and I never got out of that, and now I wanted to go to college but I can't, that all those choices are open for them. So that's what we would like to do for our mission. So today, as we talk to you, we have three learning targets. The first thing we'd like to introduce to you is the plan that we've put in place. We'd like to let you know where we are in that plan and what our next steps will be.
Okay. So I'm going to talk about our plan. So when we talk about our plan, we really looked at four components: preparedness, collaboration, instruction, or beliefs. And the reason we chose these is because we kind of had a late start in the year with this plan as we hired Kelly on at the end of August. And we weren't looking at things like our curricular resources, our schedule, because we just couldn't change something like that so close to the beginning of the year. So we're really focusing on these. So when we talk about those, preparedness and collaboration, and Kelly's going to go into more detail about this, we really started looking at our PLCs and how we can make those more strategic. And we look at collaboration and instruction. We're talking about instructional coaching, so we're looking at how we can make our instruction more effective. And then instruction and beliefs, we want to look at how we can meet some of those kids that aren't meeting their goals.
So there's a lot on this slide, so bear with us. We want to start with data. We want our formative assessment to be data-driven. And when we're talking about formative assessment, these are the check-ins that we do to be like, how are they right now? This isn't to give them a grade. It's to inform our instruction and to be able to personalize that instruction more for children. So we wanted to have data driven on that. We are collaboratively focusing on the four questions of a PLC. So our teachers were already meeting in PLCs. These were already questions that were familiar to them. But what we're having them do is to be a little bit more powerful in working together to engage in these for actually planning particular lessons. And if you look at one of the questions on there, what will we do if they don't get it? That's a key part of what we're addressing. So what we have teachers doing is doing a formative assessment on their instruction that day, having the students engage with it. And if four or five of those students show me on that assessment that they didn't get it, we'll be reteaching them. So that's really the whole thing, is when do we reteach them and how do we identify the students? There's another part of this, which is preparing lesson closure. And what we mean by that is the way math is designed now is students are engaged in the process so much more, and it's an inquiry model. And in that type of model, at the very end, we need as teachers to make that very clear what they learned in the lesson. So we're asking teachers in this part of this planning process to be intentional in their planning to make sure it happens and it's clear and we have clear representations for students.
Right, the second part of our plan, we're looking at collaboration instruction, is instructional coaching. So this year we're lucky enough to partner with the Math Institute of Wisconsin and CESA 6. For the Math Institute of Wisconsin, we have three individualized sessions that our teachers get to work with through 512. This is where they can work on their instruction and what they see in their classroom, what they individually want to work on. After those sessions, we'll have some embedded support within the district where we can continue working on that support that the learning they did with the MIW. Then we also have CESA 6 coming in with the elementary schools, focusing on our Bridges program three times per year and working with each individual school. And then our next part, instruction and beliefs in the daily reteaching. So that goes back to what Kelly talked about with the formative assessments, those daily cool downs or check-ins or checkouts. Identify students who are going to need that daily reteaching and through those formative assessments. And then the bigger lift on this, honestly, is establishing the procedures and system and times to do this. In some of our schools, we have the structures really for this, and they're set, and it's not that big of a deal. In other places, we don't, and it's just not possible. So we're looking at how we can be creative and thinking of the future, what we need for those. But that's probably the biggest thing that's kind of something we need to work on.
So this is just kind of a summary. Again, we're making the PLCs more strategic. We are doing daily reteaching, and we're doing instructional coaching to support that instruction. Notice that there's these little sunshines on there. Those are also things that are related to what we're doing at the elementary. As I said earlier, elementary is going to have their hands full, but we didn't want to ignore them altogether. And so we looked at some components that have And so I met with the principals. They're all rolling it out in their own way. But their main things are the Bridges elements have to be taught to Fidelity. There's three components in Bridges. And if we don't teach them all, if we leave out Number Corner, we leave out workplaces, what we're doing is designing holes in our curriculum, and that's catching up with us. So we want to get us back to that fidelity to those components. We're also asking them to do some kind of a daily formative assessment, whether that's on a little exit ticket or a problem that they're aware of, so that they can check in and go, okay, did my instruction work today? And if it did, how many kids are still needing some reteaching time? Or do I need to alter my instruction for tomorrow? If most of the class didn't understand my lesson today, I need to do something different tomorrow. So that's what that's all about right there. And that's really it for elementary. Everything that's also in red is what's new right now. You'll notice that the questions on top that are not in red are things teachers were already doing in some form in PLCs. We're just giving it more structure and more like focus to what they're doing.
Okay, so then we want to look at where we are in the process. So far for K-5, we started with collaboration. So Kelly and I visited nearly every classroom. There's a couple that we missed for K-5, but we met with every teacher and principal just to get a sense of where they are and what they feel their needs are. And then we met with each PLC actually for their grade level. Then we introduced our plan to the teachers and principals. After that, we actually began our PLC work where the teachers actually gave them some choice of templates, rolled out, okay, these are the non-negotiables that we'd like you to have in your PLCs and your meetings so they could begin planning. And right now we're in the PLCs in action. They are meeting and beginning of planning these, their lessons and their daily closure. Sorry, not closure, but cool downs.
Yeah, cool downs, yeah. And in K-4, again, we had to adjust the plan a little bit as we got in. So that was our first step, meeting with the principals, looking at these things that we wanted them to do, the Bridges, the exit ticket, or the components in the exit tickets. And they rolled that out. CESA 6 training was already in the docket when I got here. It had been contracted. When we looked at the contract, though, there was many, many things in it. And so we kind of refocused this to support the goals that we have. So CESA 6 is still meeting with each building 3 times, except for Silverbrook, which was part of the original plan. And she is working on them with, okay, we're going to be doing differentiation. How do we do that? Where do you find information for a cool down ticket, and how do you do that? So she's kind of supporting what we're doing in our plan. The one change that did also happen was that Silverbrook is being put in with the Math Institute work. So that training got moved to teachers that are new to Bridges. We realized there are several teachers in the district who got either repositioned or were brand new teachers, and they've never been trained on Bridges. So we repurposed that to train them. And was that everything?
Yep.
Oh, okay, great. So next steps, where do we go from here? For K-4, principals already done this. They've decided how they want to implement their buildings. I've been presenting at some of them to help them out, and some wanted to do it in-house, so that's been great. We've designed a lesson elements based on research, which is a guide for what a lesson should include as you're teaching math. So everybody has the same language so that principals come in and talk to them about their lessons and know what to expect. Math is its own little animal, and sometimes the people who are coming in don't know what to look for, and it gives them those look-fors, and it gives math teachers an expectation of what lessons should be included within it, and it's also going to be the tool that they can set their goals around as they're working with the Math Institute, so that the goals are all aligned to what we want in an instructional framework based on research. And then we are going to continue the CESA 6, the site-based, and the new to Bridges training.
All right, so for 5-12, again, we're rolling out those elements. The teachers are going to see those on Monday, and when we have our PD day. So we're going to continue work in PLCs, and hopefully our PLC work is starting to be reflected in the classroom, because, again, that's kind of just begun. Some of the teams were planning ahead because they didn't want to do the unit they're in, so they said, okay, let's look ahead to the next chapter, next unit. So we're really hoping to see that in their classrooms coming up. And we do have some teachers who have already started that. And 27th, also, we're beginning our coaching with the Math Institute of Wisconsin. So that's kind of the first day we're rolling that out. Again, obviously, we're not doing coaching, but they're going to meet the coaches and do some planning with them. And then our other next step is, again, determining that system for reteaching, which, again, in my opinion, is one of our biggest reaches, and it's going to be one of our hardest things to do. So this is just the overall timeline for the year. So if we look at this, we're just in the beginning of quarter two. So really, we're looking at the November 27th date, where we have some PD with the Math Institute of Wisconsin to introduce those lesson elements tool and introduce instructional coaching with the team. Other than that, you can kind of see we have all those dates in there that they have their coaching cycles with the teachers, and then their final date of their student learning objective would be the end of the quarter. Mm-hmm. And we have a similar timeline for K-4.
Yeah. K-4, if you look at this one, is primarily just the CSIS-6 trainings that are put within that timeline, because that's their main thing, and then the New to Bridges training. On the New to Bridges, it wasn't just a one-shot thing where she worked with them on the one day to introduce the components. She's going to be coming back to do some individualized coaching with those new teachers as well. So that's what those additional days are within there.
Right. And then we have some helpful links. These are provided to the teachers. So again, we didn't want to leave them like high and dry, so you need to do all this stuff, but we gave them some templates to work with and some other resources that feel free to look at.
Mm-hmm. And so finally, do you have any questions for us?
I just wanted to clarify, you said PLCs a lot. For anybody watching at home, what might that mean?
I mean, it's funny, we talked about that. We're like, oh, we got to make sure we cut down the jargon a little bit.
And we didn't.
No, we didn't. We actually talked about that. So professional learning communities.
That's what I thought.
Thank you. And we did cut down some of the jargon, so.
I would like to applaud our two members here on this committee, on this team, because it is extraordinary, in my experience, to have true site observations, true design elements based on those observations. I mean, it's hard enough. There's almost 6,000 students, and many, many classrooms in which to observe them. And so, your sampling technique and your observation records and your conclusions from them were very impressive. And so their design here, I think, is well done. And then on top of that, you have the support structures that are typically touted as, you know, significant when we talk about improvement efforts. And lastly, it's very hard to have clear goals when you are moving people to a place that is improved. And there could be a lot of resistance. There's a lot of change in people's professional lives when we have these design build support structures that have clear targets. But what I really appreciate is that I do believe, in my professional opinion, that it is designed well, built well, with the supports in place, with clear targets, and really the persistence, because that mission that you identified is actually a life changer for students. And so that is really fuel for our team and fuel for all of our principals who are in front of this and all of our teachers who are, going to jump on. So I appreciate that very much. Thank you.
All right. Well, it looks like we are through our last agenda item. So I will go ahead and exit the meeting.
Oh, could I say a few words of thanks? Because we have Thanksgiving right in a few days, and everybody's kind of waiting for it. But this is my first Thanksgiving with our team and with this committee. And so I would like to extend on behalf of our committee and the district how thankful we are that you are in service to our students and in service on this committee. And we've been telling everybody to eat a lot, but I truly, truly wish you and everyone here and everyone listening out there that we have abundance and we have warmth with our family and our friends and food. So thank you very much.
All right. Well, thank you. Then I shall go ahead and close the meeting. It is 5:08 p.m. Thank you, everybody.